14. 9/11 and the Hutchison Effect, an Ace in the Hole, Part 2. August 19, 2008. Some time ago, I posted a series of three articles which attempted to document the peculiar machinations of Alexander Ace Baker and Professor Jim Fetzer in relation to a study posted by Dr. Judy Wood regarding 9/11 evidence and Hutchison Effect evidence 89. Dr. Wood also posted an article highlighting the unusual attitude that Jim Fetzer took to John Hutchison when John appeared as a guest on his Dynamic Duos show on February 28, 2008. In the articles I wrote, I contended that the evidence collected by Dr. Wood, and the reaction to the same evidence, strongly implied that the basic thrust of the argument is correct. That some type of technology related to that used to create the Hutchison effect was indeed employed in 9/11. Since Dr. Wood posted her original Hutchison effect study in early 2008, she has posted an additional series, which includes a good deal of data regarding Hurricane Erin, which was closest to NYC during the events of 9/11. As part of this study, Dr. Wood has obtained magnetometer data, logged by instruments in Alaska during the events of 9/11. These data show very interesting variations in the Earth's magnetic field during the events of 9/11. Reaction to this study seems to have been more muted, though the data is now getting some exposure. Dr. Wood and I were invited by Jim Fetzer to make two appearances in his Dynamic Duo show slot on GCN Live. These two appearances took place on July 30, 2008 and July 31, 2008, and will be the subject of a separate article. Decoy and Distract. On August 18, 2008, Dr. Wood and I received an email from Ace Baker with the subject: Ace Baker-$100,000 Hutchison Effect Challenge. Ace Baker was apparently offering $100,000 if John and or Dr. Wood can reproduce the H effect. The message contained a link to an entry on his blog, in which he set out the general terms of his challenge. Strangely, however, Ace neglected to include John and the CC or to Fields. When Dr. Wood noticed this, she forwarded her copy of Ace's email to John. John Hutchison is, at times, quite a prolific blogger himself, 92, and he contacted Dr. Wood to state that he had posted a response to Ace Baker's challenge on Ace Baker's own blog, but it seems as though it was not approved or posted there. John advised us of the general contents of his post, from memory, soon after he had tried to post it. Sometime previously, Ace had offered a sum of $5,000 if he could film Hutchison effects in John's lab, but Ace never followed through, so this seemed to represent a substantially larger offer. However, I was very curious about this new offer, because Ace had previously stated John Hutchison is a 100% fraud. If Ace believed this, then what was the point of offering a large sum of money? I was therefore given to ask Ace Baker the following questions: 1. Who would he be approaching to validate the effects, and how will their qualifications compare to those of George Hathaway, Colonel John Alexander, Hal Puthoff and others? They have already been involved with evaluating and documenting John Hutchison's experiments. 2. Why was Ace willing to put up this amount of money for this demonstration, as opposed to, say, putting it into a legal case to sue the media regarding TV fakery? I asked Ace Baker this question because he has stated he is an expert in video fakery and has published a detailed study on the 9/11 Chopper 5 video, in which he concludes that the video has been heavily doctored, using video compositing, to present fake images as real. 3. If Hutchison effect-like technology was not employed on 9/11, then would Ace be willing to pay for research to answer questions regarding A. inverted cars, B. Horseshoe beam C. Explosion of Scott Pax D. Witness accounts of levitation effects, etc. In other words, I was trying to ask if Ace wanted to see the truth of 9/11 uncovered. He did not dispute the validity of the points of evidence A, D, above. Finally, I asked him, 4. What were his thoughts on A, the hurricane's path, B, the Alaskan magnetometer data? In the same message, I said I was very interested in alternative explanations, based on good evidence, for the effects seen on 9/11, as I thought that this is what the search for 9/11 truth was for. I stated that I was open to a different, consistent interpretation of the evidence, if it answered all the questions regarding that same evidence. In Ace's response, he answered question 1 thus, 1. Hutchison would are free to discuss any details clarifications should they decide to accept the challenge. This was not relevant to the question I asked. I asked who would help him to validate that the effects were real. Was Ace trying to divert his answers away from dealing with the evidence? 2. I am willing to offer $100,000 to FOX5 to license broadcast quality Chopper 5 footage. That challenge coming soon. This also did not really answer the question I asked. I actually queried him about possibly making a legal challenge, based on his TV fakery research. Instead, he seemed to answer this by describing a proposed bet with FOX5. Again, it seemed as if Ace was diverting away from the evidence I was asking him about. He didn't respond at all regarding the issue of legal action being taken. In answering the third question, Ace said, 3. There is no Hutchison effect to have been employed on 9/11. No. I am not willing to offer $100,000 to some people. The purpose of this challenge is to demonstrate to the public that Hutchison and Wood are liars. Here, he did not seem to interpret the spirit of my question as I had intended. I intended it to mean would he be prepared to fund research, rather than fund debunking. Would he be prepared, in principle, to fund research to advance an alternative explanation? In his answer, he seemed to be stating that he was wanting to prove that John Hutchison was a liar and Dr. Wood was a liar, independent of the facts put before him, both in this email exchange and in earlier ones. Also, it is not called the Hutchison and Wood effect. This, to me, shows a disturbing lack of desire to discover what actually happened on 9/11. If Dr. Wood's study is incomplete or inaccurate or even inappropriate, then why can't Ace come up with a better method to find the correct explanation? How will proving John Hutchison a fraud even though Ace was already convinced of this help determine what did happen on 9/11? I was given to ask myself, therefore, what is Ace's true intent and focus? Who was he doing this stunt for? Himself. In his answer to question 4, again he seems to blatantly ignore data. 4. The challenge has nothing whatsoever to do with Hurricane Aaron or the Alaskan magnetometer data. It has to do with the scientific claims made by John Hutchison. Hutchison's claims predate 9/11. And continue to this day. Could it be that there is a strategy to distract people away from looking at the basic data, which starts to clearly show that field effects, for example, effects on the Earth's magnetic field did indeed play a significant role on 9/11? Is all this an exercise to create more and more forum verbiage to drown out any serious discussion of evidence? Is he trying to set up a fake exercise to test the existence of something which has already generated over 500 pounds of anomalous metal samples? I must admit to being somewhat surprised at Ace Baker's answers to these four questions, especially his apparent blanking of the Hurricane Aaron data, So to clarify this, I sent one further email with some follow-up questions. I asked him if his Hutchison effect challenge really had nothing to do with 9/11 research. He replied, 1. Wrong. The Hutchison effect challenge is related to 9/11 research, in that it will require honest researchers to eliminate Hutchison effect from consideration. I then asked him if he thought Hurricane Aaron was not relevant to what happened on 9/11. He responded, 2. Right. Hurricane Aaron is unrelated to 9/11. Finally, I asked him if he really had no interest in finding out how the towers were dustified on 9/11. He said, 3. Wrong. I am very interested to learn how the towers were blown up. But I'm also interested in documenting the strategy of the GovernMedia PSYOP team. So what strategy has ACE documented? On his blog, he has repeated several times that John Hutchison is a fraud and has simply just made some fake videos. ACE has made his own fake videos, simulating two or three of the effects incompletely. ACE has also completed a study of TV fakery. In both cases, he has not moved his evidence into a legal framework, as Dr. Wood has done. He has not submitted an affidavit in a court case, as John Hutchison has done. I also submitted an affidavit for Dr. Wood's Qui Tam case. ACE Baker's double standard? It is worth mentioning that Dr. Wood is not the only person to have suggested how the WTC complex was destroyed. People such as Dr. Stephen E. Jones have suggested thermite or thermite or some variant thereof was used to destroy the WTC. Edward and others have previously stated that micro-nukes must have been used. ACE Baker has not, however, offered $100,000 to Professor Steve E. Jones for a demonstration of thermite, nor has he offered Ed Ward, or anyone else to my knowledge, any sum of money for a demonstration of micro-nuke technology. If ACE was being even-handed in his assessment of 9/11 research, surely he would have made such an offer when these theories were first put on the table. Can we conclude there is some special reason why linking 9/11 and the Hutchison effect is so dangerous? Observations conclusions. ACE said he was convinced that John Hutchison was a 100% fraud, but ACE was still willing to offer $100,000 and travel to Vancouver at his own expense as part of this challenge. Why? ACE seemed less interested in using his own TV fakery research in some kind of legal action than he did in attempting to debunk John Hutchison and essentially Dr. Judy Wood too. At appearances in Seattle and Portland, John Hutchison brought some of his samples as an exhibit. He allowed the audience to examine and photograph these samples. If John were a fraud, why would he do such a thing? So, it is clear to those people who handled the samples that the things they were holding in their hands were not the result of video fakery. Also, many samples have been given to other people around the world, so we have lots of physical evidence which shows the Hutchison effect is real. ACE Baker had previously offered to come and meet Dr. Wood in Seattle in 2006. At a presentation she was giving then. The presentations that Dr. Wood and John Hutchison gave in Seattle and Portland in May-June 2008 were advertised weeks or even months in advance. ACE could have attended one or both of these presentations if he wanted to. He could have seen the samples for himself. So why wasn't ACE there to ask questions and to examine the samples? Below are a few of many photos the Dr. Wood herself took on one of her trips to see John Hutchison. ACE was not interested in the relevance of the Hurricane Aaron study, despite the clear evidence of field effects in relation to the hurricane itself, 9/11 and the Hutchison effect. Why? Ace seemed to say he did not want to fund research into an alternative explanation for the destruction of the towers, yet he said he was interested in how they were destroyed. Does this make sense? If he is genuinely interested in finding out what happened on 9/11, then why didn't he offer or consider finding some better alternatives? I leave the reader to draw their own conclusions about the overall meaning of this episode. Does it illustrate how the cover-up of 9/11 truth is working? Addendum, Ace Baker on Dynamic Duo, August 26, 2008. On August 26, 2008, Ace Baker appeared on the Dynamic Duo. Part of a segment in the first hour discussed Ace Baker's challenge and mentioned the posting of this article before this addendum was posted. At time code 236 in this clip, he stated, "In regard to this challenge I've been getting the hate correspondence from Andrew Johnson and so forth." This was a curious statement, as all the emails I have recently exchanged with Baker are included in this article in their entirety. Why couldn't Ace's description have been more accurate, saying I have been getting correspondence from Andrew Johnson or I have been getting critical correspondence from Andrew Johnson or even Andrew Johnson asked me some questions about this, to which I responded. Anyone reading this article and the emails can clearly see there is no hate correspondence here. Additionally, it is not my style to indulge in such correspondence, as a study of my web postings, articles etc. will reveal. He then discussed my website and how I posted the earlier articles in this series. He then referred to the email that John Hutchison sent to Dr. Judy Wood, which she forwarded to me regarding John's attempted blog entry posting. Ace incorrectly states that John Hutchison contacted me directly. He did not, as the email header shows. Fetzer then read out the title of this article, Ace in the Hole Part 2, and the subtitle I posted on the front page, which read, "What is the real motive behind Ace Baker's new Hutchison effect challenge?" Fetzer then stated, "Oh, that's great. I love it when people start speculating on motives." Ace then adds, "My motive is to get people to believe that Hutchison is a fake. That's my motive." So, are Baker and Fetzer unconcerned with the large volume of evidence that John has amassed? It seems pointless to ask this sort of question too many times. Ace Baker then reads out John's email, but fails to mention that this text is what John Hutchison attempted to post on Ace Baker's blog, and that it was John's best recall of it. An entry posted on a blog is normally lost if the user does not make a copy, and it is subsequently not approved. Fetzer then reasserts that his treatment of John Hutchison, when he appeared on Fetzer's show, was justified, because of John's background. He then says, "This is something that Judy Wood, Andrew Johnson and others don't seem to have processed. I think evidence presented here shows that I, and others, have very much processed what Jim Fetzer has been doing. And I have documented evidence to suggest what his motive could be." In the second hour, a caller John from Canada rightly pointed out that just because Ace has produced a video which reproduces some of the aspects of the Hutchison effect, it does not prove that John Hutchison is a fraud. Fetzer agreed with this logic. The caller then does quite a good job of mentioning the additional evidence such as the metal samples and Dr. Wood's comparison to the effects seen on 9/11, but even though he appears to have read this article, he failed to mention Ace's opportunity to meet John Hutchison in Seattle. However, Ace then responds and says, "I don't think that Dr. Wood believes in it, the Hutchison effect. Unfortunately, I've come to the opinion that Judy Wood is fits right into the model of disinformation." Curiously, Ace then reasserts his general support for the rest of Dr. Wood's 9/11 research and study of what happened at the WTC and states that she is absolutely right about the effects seen, such as destification of the towers, the bent beams, etc. Perhaps ironically, most of the remainder of the show is taken up with Ace's discussion of his model of the ways disinformation can be promoted. What was the purpose, if any, of this broadcast with Ace Baker and Jim Fetzer? Challenge. Strangely, however, Ace neglected to include John and the CC or to Fields. When Dr. Wood noticed this, she forwarded her copy of Ace's email to John. John Hutchison is, at times, quite a prolific blogger himself, 92, and he contacted Dr. Wood to state that he had posted a response to Ace Baker's challenge on Ace Baker's own blog, but it seems as though it was not approved or posted there. John advised us of the general contents of his post, from memory, soon after Clay's on July 30, 2008 and July 31, 2008, and will be the subject of a separate article. Decoy and Distract? On August 18, 2008, Dr. Wood and I received an email from Ace Baker with the subject, Ace Baker-$100,000 Hutchison Effect Challenge. Ace Baker was apparently offering $100,000 if John and or Dr. Wood can reproduce the H effect. The message contained a link to an entry on his blog, in which he set out the general terms of his challenge. 14. 9/11 and the Hutchison Effect, an Ace in the Hole, Part 2. August 19, 2008. Some time ago, I posted a series of three articles which attempted to document the peculiar machinations of Alexander Ace Baker and Professor Jim Fetzer in relation to a study posted by Dr. Judy Wood regarding 9/11 evidence and Hutchison effect evidence. 89. Dr. Wood also posted an article highlighting the unusual attitude that Jim Fetzer took to John Hutchison when John appeared as a guest on his Dynamic Duo show on February 28, 2008. In the articles I wrote, I contended that the evidence collected by Dr. Wood, and the reaction to the same evidence, strongly implied that the basic thrust of the argument is correct, that some type of technology related to that used to create the Hutchison effect was indeed employed in 9/11. Since Dr. Wood posted her original Hutchison effect study in early 2008, she has posted an additional series, which includes a good deal of data regarding Hurricane Erin, which was closest to NYC during the events of 9/11. As part of this study, Dr. Wood has obtained magnetometer data, logged by instruments in Alaska during the events of 9/11. These data show very interesting variations in the Earth's magnetic field during the events of 9/11. Reaction to this study seems to have been more muted, though the data is now getting some exposure. Dr. Wood and I were invited by Jim Fetzer to make two appearances in his Dynamic Duo show slot on GCN Live. These two appearances took